Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures. And we thank you, Father, for your word today. We thank you that we're coming up upon the Feast of Purim. And I just pray for everybody here and who's online to be able to receive what you've given me to say here today about fasting. And I just come against whatever spirits would be trying to block that, because there's a lot of people who, when they hear the word fasting, they shut down, don't want to do that, don't want to have anything to do with that. So I just come against those spirits in the name of Yeshua. Amen. Amen. Well, the story of Purim, is going to be summarizing it just a little bit. And next Shabbat, Rabbi David will be here and we'll be speaking about Purim a whole lot more. But I'm going to just give a short summary so you understand. This event happened about 600 years before the time of Yeshua. And Israel was conquered by the Babylonian Empire, and all the people were either killed or exiled into Babylon and other parts of the empire. And then soon after that, Babylon was conquered by the Persians. And King Ahasuerus, which is always something that I try to get people to say. Want to try it? Ahasuerus. Okay. You'll see it in your English Bibles as something like Xerxes and very other attempts at it. He was convinced by an Amalekite who had this name. I think it was Haman. No foot stomping. You got to have some foot stomping. Haman. All right. He was convinced to issue a decree to kill all the Jewish people in his empire. Basically, genocide. And the Amalekites had attacked the Israelites as they left Egypt. And Israel had defeated them and defeated them again during the reign of King Saul. And Haman, his hatred of the Jewish people was incited by a spirit. And we call it the spirit of Amalek. And God commands us in Deuteronomy chapter 25 to remember what happened and what God's intention for the spirit of Amalek is. In verse 17, it says, "Remember what Amalek did to you along the way as you came out from Egypt." In verse 18, "How he happened upon you along the way, attacked those among you in the rear, all the stragglers behind you. When you were tired and weary, he did not fear God." Verse 19, "Now when Adonai, the Lord your God, grants you rest from all the enemies surrounding you in the land Adonai your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, you are to blot out the memory of Amalek from under the heavens. Do not forget." So the memory of Amalek has not been blotted out because the spirit of Amalek keeps rising up and inciting violence. And I believe it's still around today, inciting the violence in the Ukraine against Jewish Ukrainians and all the other Ukrainians. Well, to get back to Babylon, the Jewish people were in great danger of destruction. There was no way to avoid it, and they were desperate. Mordecai was a righteous Jewish man living in the Persian capital. And he asked his cousin Esther, a Jewish woman who miraculously had become queen, to intercede with the king for the Jewish people. But Esther did not have access to the king. If she approached him without permission, she would be executed. So there was basically in the natural nothing that she could do, and she was desperate also. And in her desperation, Esther decided to spend 3 days in prayer and fasting. And she asked all the Jewish people in the empire to pray and fast with her. And after those 3 days, Esther went to the king uninvited, and God answered their prayers, and she found favor with the king. Esther told the king that his decree meant she would be killed, along with all the other Jewish people. And the king changed his mind, and all the Jewish people in Persia were spared, and the evil Haman was executed. So in remembrance of Esther's fast. It's traditional to pray and fast for 3 days preceding Purim, and it's called an Esther fast. So we'll be praying and fasting, as you heard, from sundown Sunday until sundown on Wednesday, when Purim actually begins at sundown on Wednesday. And you're all invited to the 3 prayer meetings, whether you're fasting or not, Monday through Wednesday at 6 o'clock. And Esther and her attendants, if you read the story, actually did a very extreme fast. They fasted food and water. And that's a very, very difficult fast. I do not recommend that for anybody. What I do want you to all understand, that fasting does not have to be anywhere near that difficult. You can fast one meal a day, 2 meals a day, or you can fast some pleasurable thing like TV or the internet or something else. It's up to you to be led by the Spirit. And very important, those who are not physically able to fast food due to a medical condition, please do not try to do it. Do not fast. So in preparation for the Esther fast, the Holy Spirit led me to speak about fasting so that all of you would have a greater understanding of what this is all about. And I'll start with out by saying, I don't like fasting. I like to eat. But I've experienced some amazing moves of God when I have fasted. I'll just share about one of them. This was a long time ago when the Lord first called me to reach out to the Jewish people around me, my Jewish people. There was no congregation Shema Yisrael. There were a couple of small groups meeting, and they were praying for a move of the Holy Spirit upon the Jewish community of Rochester here too. And the Spirit led me to fast one day a week for a year and pray for that move of God's Spirit. And at the end of the year, a group of us were called upon to connect with Israel Cohen from Chosen People Ministries, who came and organized us to reach out to the Jewish community. And a year after that, Jonathan Burness came and started Congregation Shema Yisrael. So you could say that was all kind of coincidental timing, but I believe it was an answer to my prayer and fasting and others' prayers. And that was a turning point for me about fasting, that it was so amazing, the timing there. So besides tradition, what is the biblical reason for this fast or for any fast? So in the Bible, there's one time when the Lord commands us to fast, and we're going to take a look at that just to see a little bit about what it is. It's in Leviticus chapter 23 and starting in verse 27, talking about Yom Kippur. However, the 10th day of the 7th month is Yom Kippur, a holy convocation to you. Yom Kippur is the Day of Atonement. So you are to afflict yourselves. You are to bring an offering made by fire to Adonai, the Lord. Verse 26, you are not to do any kind of work on that set day, for it is Yom Kippur, to make atonement for you before the Lord your God. So here's what that's all about. In the times when the temple was standing in Jerusalem, Yom Kippur was the day when atonement was made for the entire nation of Israel by sacrificing animals. And the symbolism there is that the innocent animal would pay the price for the nation's sin. And for the atonement to be meaningful to the people of Israel, they needed to have contrite hearts before God. A contrite heart is a heart that's willing to be shown how God wants you to change. So that was needed for the people to participate in Yom Kippur with the right attitude. Now, when we think about sin, getting rid of sin in our lives, most people think of the big sins, like murder and stealing and adultery. But there's also secret sin, hidden sin that other people can't see. And we also need to remember that sin is more than words and action. The Bible uses a word, avon, very, very frequently, and it's translated iniquity, properly translated. And iniquity is thoughts and attitudes that are ungodly and beliefs that are ungodly. So iniquity is sin as well as sins of speech and action. So just a few things that would be iniquity. Judging others, envy, bitterness, pride, unbelief, unforgiveness, fear, self-hatred, any ungodly attitude is iniquity. And sometimes we can't see iniquity in ourselves. And that's what fasting is for, one of the reasons. On Yom Kippur, the Bible commanded all the people of Israel to afflict their souls. And the Hebrew for that phrase is, initem et nashotechem, humble yourselves. It comes from the root word anah, which is to humble. So what this is about is, on Yom Kippur, was to make yourself contrite and open to hearing about the secret sins, because everybody knows what our open sins are, and actually sometimes other people know what your open sins are. But the secret sins that we are not aware of, to hear about that from the Holy Spirit. And the traditional reading on Yom Kippur is Isaiah chapter 58, because it talks about fasting and humbling ourselves. And it describes the fasting that God approves and the fasting that he disapproves. So we're going to look through all of those verses in Isaiah 58. But a little background is that in Isaiah's time, the people of Israel were not very righteous. They had lots of issues with God. But they were fasting on Yom Kippur, and they were frustrated because it seemed like God was not answering them. And in Isaiah 58, verse 3, Isaiah is saying, this is what the people were saying. Why have we fasted, yet you do not see? Why have we afflicted our souls, yet you take no notice? So they were following God's command to afflict their souls and were fasting food, but were not being blessed by God for their afflicting and fasting. It seemed that God didn't reward them or even notice them. Now, this verse uses two different Hebrew words for fast and afflict our souls. The Hebrew word for fast is samnu, and that speaks of fasting food. And the Hebrew word for afflicting our souls is ininu nafshehnu. Ininu nafshehu, that same root of anah, of afflicting yourself. So the first purpose of fasting is to spend time humbling yourself before the Lord, cultivating a contrite heart, which the Lord loves. So breaking down a hardness of heart that says, I'm not going to hear, you know, God doesn't need to speak to me. I got everything together. I don't need any help. So now let's look at some other purposes of fasting. Usually when we fast, we call it a time of prayer and fasting. So the second very important purpose of times of prayer and fasting is that fasting gives you power over Satan, over our adversary, over the forces of evil. And we've been talking about this a lot, but I'll read it again here in James chapter 4, verse 6. But the grace he gives is greater, which is why it says, God opposes the arrogant, but to the humble he gives grace. Now that's nice, but listen to verse 7. Therefore, submit to God, obviously by humbling yourself. Moreover, take a stand against the adversary, that's Satan, and he will flee from you. So when you humble yourself before God and afflict your soul, you will be able to take a stand against Satan and he will flee from you. You'll have victory over Satan's opposition, which usually is in the form of deceptions. And the New Covenant confirms this supernatural power against the forces of evil. That you get that power when there's prayer and fasting. In an incident recorded in Mark chapter 9, Yeshua was away from his disciples, and people came to his disciples and asked them to cast a demon out of a young man, and they couldn't do it. They were unable. And then Yeshua came upon them, and he cast the demon out. And they asked him, why weren't we able to cast it out? And in Mark chapter 9, verse 29, Yeshua said to them, this kind can't come out by nothing but prayer and fasting. So Yeshua is saying here that prayer and fasting gives power over spirits that are too strong to come out in some other way. Also in the New Covenant, if you read through it, you find Paul speaks about oftentimes prayer and fasting. The leaders of the Messianic congregations all around the Roman Empire prayed and prayed and fasted. So the third purpose of fasting, which is very practical, is that if you fast food, it frees up time to pray and seek the Lord. Because preparing, eating, cleaning up from three meals a day takes about 2 hours, which can be spent in prayer. The fourth purpose for prayer and fasting is that it gives us a strong incentive to pray. Because if we make the sacrifice of going without food or something else that's pleasurable, and we make that to pray and we don't actually spend time praying, we'll feel like we denied ourselves for nothing. Gee, I went through that and I didn't actually spend any time praying. Fifth purpose for fasting and prayer is praying for a particular need. It's a way of demonstrating to God that you are desperate for Him to move in that situation. It's so important to you that you're willing to go without food to show God how much you want Him to move and answer your prayer. So in this purpose, prayer and fasting is somewhat like making a sacrifice to God. Now, we usually think of sacrifices being made to make atonement for sin, but some sacrifices, particularly actually in this week's parsha in Leviticus chapter 1 through 5, they're made when a person was asking God to answer their prayer. It was like saying to God, I want this so much that I'm sacrificing this to you now in the hope that you'll answer my prayer. So here's an example of it. Elijah was a prophet, and he was contending with the priests of Baal. The priests of Baal were idolaters, and they were contending over who was really God. So he sacrificed a bull, and he prayed for a manifestation of God's power. And in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 36, this is the account. Now, it was at the time of offering up the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Adonai, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Verse 37, answer me, Adonai, answer me, so that these people may know that you, Adonai, are God, and that you have turned their heart back again. Verse 38, then the fire of Adonai fell and consumed the burnt offering and the wood, the stones and the dust, and licked up the water that was in a trench. When all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, Adonai, he is God. Adonai, he is God. So the sacrifice bull was a part of this manifestation of God. Sacrifices were a way of demonstrating to God how important the prayers of the people in the times of the temple, in the times of the Tanakh, the Old Testament, were. But, according to Leviticus chapter 17, verses 8 and 9, animal sacrifices can no longer be made because there is no tabernacle or temple in Jerusalem. But, two buts, fasting is a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice of meals or some pleasurable thing. So the sixth purpose of prayer and fasting is to make a sacrifice. Make a sacrifice to entreat God to move. And the sacrifice is what you're giving up. I'm giving this up. I'm sacrificing this to you for this time or these days so that you know that I really need you to move in this area. The seventh purpose of prayer and fasting is that it enables you to better hear from God. You're less distracted by earthly things during this time. And then in the rest of Isaiah 58, God answers the people's question as to why he is not hearing them. While they're fasting, afflicting their souls, it says this, behold, in the day of your fast, you seek your own pleasure. So they were still finding pleasure some other ways. They were not serious about this. And then he goes on in verse 3 again, and exploit all your laborers. So those who own businesses or farms or have people working in their homes, they were not giving them a day off even at this time, probably for Yom Kippur. Verse 4, behold, you fast for strife and contention and to strike with a wicked fist. Strife is criticizing, putting others down, quarreling, and striking with a fist, actually hurting others, whether it's physically or verbally. So the people were being divisive and cruel, even on their holy day of fasting and afterwards. Verse 4, you should not fast as you do today to make your voice heard on high. I'm not going to listen to you if this is the attitude you have, the way you behave even though you're fasting. And then the Lord addressed the religious things the people were doing. Verse 5, is this the fast I have chosen, a day for one to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head like a reed and spreading out sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a day, this a fast and a day acceptable to Adonai? Well, this is pretty heavy. These were things people did in that culture traditionally when they were fasting. They wore sackcloth, which was very coarse material, so it was uncomfortable and humbling. And they placed ashes on themselves to demonstrate humility. And God was saying, even if you humble yourself publicly like this, it's not necessarily an acceptable fast to me. Then the Lord turned and he began to describe what makes a fast acceptable and chosen. And to me, this switch here, it just so reveals the heart of God about what's really important to God. It's just so precious. Verse 6, is not this the fast that I choose, to release the bonds of wickedness, to untie the cords of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to tear off every yoke? What are these bonds of wickedness, heavy burdens, and yokes? Who are the oppressed? Well, it sounds like people in slavery. And remember, slavery was legal in those days as a means of paying off debts. But the Bible commanded slave owners to treat their slaves well. So the bonds of wickedness, heavy burdens, and yokes would have been on people who were unjustly enslaved or treated cruelly while enslaved. So the first thing that makes a fast acceptable or chosen to the Lord is setting people free who are being unjustly or cruelly treated in bondage. So now, how did this purpose for fasting apply to the Jewish people in the Empire of Persia? Well, they were severely oppressed. They were awaiting genocide, basically. Can you imagine the fear that they were under for themselves, for their loved ones? And this applies to a purpose for fasting in our times right now. The plight of the people in Ukraine is heavy on our hearts, and they are being oppressed. And just so everybody understands, our congregation has been very involved in bringing the good news to the Ukraine. We are part of Jonathan Burness, who is our founding rabbi, and David Levine, our second rabbi, their work here. They planted about 24 Messianic congregations in the former Soviet Union and in the Ukraine. And the way they got started there was that Jonathan would organize festivals of Jewish music in the cities of the former Soviet Union. And I remember spending hours praying for those festivals. And the incredible thing is that we learned the names of the cities because the festivals were going to be there. It's so hard to pronounce. But now we're seeing those names as places that are being bombed, that are being shelled. The one that was the hardest. Ready for this one? Dnepropetrovsk was one of the places where the festivals were, and it's being bombed. Zhytomyr, Kharkov, Kiev, all of these cities were places where the festivals, and we prayed for those cities. And I've actually spent time at conferences with Messianic rabbis from many of those cities that were brought over through the generosity of the Messianic Jewish Alliance of America. They were brought over to participate in the conferences, and I got to know quite a few of them. So this is why it's so much on our heart. And the innocent Ukrainians are experiencing just incredible unjust and cruel oppression treatment today, being killed. Their homes are being destroyed. The last count I saw yesterday, over 2.5 million have left their homes and fled to neighboring countries. Married couples are being separated, with the women and children leaving, and the men staying to fight, have to go back to fight with the Ukrainian army. Soldiers and those journeying up fighting the Russians, they're oppressed also. Can you imagine the fear of facing the Russian army? Fear of being killed, wounded, or captured. And you know who else is being oppressed? Russian soldiers. There are Russian soldiers who are being forced to fight against their will. We've been seeing lots of stories of that. And they're under the yoke. And there are many people in Russia who have been able to see through the propaganda of the Russian government. And they know the truth about what's happening in Ukraine. And many of them, if you follow the news, have been out on the streets protesting, and they've been arrested by the Russian government, thrown into jail. So they're yes, thousands, they're in jail, they're oppressed, they're under the yoke. So because of all this, we are we are frustrated by our inability to help out. Jana and Albert sent some supplies over, but don't you wish you could do more? What more? So much more. We're going to be praying intensely during our Esther fast for what's going on, for the people of Ukraine, for the Russian soldiers, for the Russian people. Okay, verse 7. Is it not to share, this is again what the Lord says is his appointed fast. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, to bring the homeless poor into your house, when you see the naked, to cover them? Well, the second thing that makes a fast acceptable for the Lord, to the Lord, is to care for the needy. And again, 2.5 million refugees pouring into neighboring country with nothing but the clothes on their back and maybe one suitcase. Just so heartbreaking. The basic necessities of life, food, water, medicine, clothing, and shelter. These countries that are accepting them, they're not rich countries. And they're reaching out to help them. Thank you for all who gave, and you can still give, as Pastor Tom said, true helping in the Ukraine. But also, we regularly support a ministry called Reach Initiative International. Some of you remember Stuart and Chantel Winograd. It's been a few years, but they used to come here every year to share what they are doing in the former Soviet Union. They planted a congregation in Minsk in Belarus, and that congregation is still flourishing in the midst of a very oppressive communist government. But other congregations came out of that one, and they actually, I got an email from that like 3 days ago, they actually traveled to Ukraine. And they are on the border between Ukraine and Romania. They're in Romania, and they're helping out. They're even going into Ukraine to help the people in Ukraine to get out. They rented a van, or they bought a van. It's just so courageous what they are doing. We also support Jezreel International Ministry in Albany with Barry and Tony Feynman, and they send humanitarian aid to Ukraine in shipping containers. So that's still going on. And another person that some of you might know that we don't actually support with our funds, but Patrick LaBarbera is our health insurance broker for the congregation. Huh? Pasquale, I'm sorry. Pat, he calls himself Pat, so Pasquale. He's a missionary to the Ukraine. And he hasn't been able to be there for the past few years, but he got up and flew over there, brought money that he collected, and he's helping the people there too. So it's just we wish you could do more. And the heartbreaking thing for me is that our government seems to be incapable of intervening out of fear of starting World War III. And it just seems like there's so little we can do, but we can pray, and God can move. Because we need miracles. These people over there need miracles. Verse 7, and not hide yourself from your own flesh and blood. So this is the third criterion. Take care of your family responsibilities. And I guess what came to me about this and about Ukraine is that we have spiritual family in the Ukraine. Messianic congregations, Messianic rabbis and their families. And that's why I think some of us are so passionate about helping them. And then God tells us his rewards for his kind of fasting. Verse 8, then your light will break forth like the dawn. Your healing will spring up speedily. Healing, wholeness, physical, emotional, mental, relational healing shall come quickly. Well, we certainly can use some of that here, but we can also use it over in the Ukraine where the people are being hit with mortars and shells and the trauma is just huge. It's huge. Verse 8, your righteousness will go before you, the glory of Adonai as your rear guard. Then you will call, verse 9, and Adonai will answer. You will cry, and he will say, Hineni, here I am. So this confirms the fifth and sixth purposes for prayer and fasting. Because God's saying, when you're praying, when you're fasting the way I want you to fast, what's acceptable to me, I will hear your prayer. And I will move. And what he says here is really astounding. It's astounding. This confirms, you know, that prayer and fasting is a way of demonstrating to God that this is really important to you, and it's like making a sacrifice. But there's a promise in here that I want everybody to make sure they grasp, because it will give you great faith. When you fast in a way that is acceptable to God, God says he will answer hineni. What does that mean? That's what Abraham answered to God when God called him. And what it means, I am here to do your will. Okay, now grasp this. This is God saying, I am here to do your will. It doesn't say that anywhere else in the Bible. This is the only time God says hineni to people. People say hineni to God all the time. God, I'm here to do your will. But God says hineni to people, and it's when your fast is acceptable to the Lord. So this is amazing. And again, he goes back and adds a couple of other things. If you get rid of the yoke among you, finger pointing and bad mouthing. So he adds a couple of new things here to get rid of. I always like the illustration. I think somebody used it here recently. Pointing the finger, accusing others of evil, judging others, blaming. And if you look at your hand, you got one finger pointing at somebody else, but what do you have pointing at yourself? You have three fingers pointing at yourself, right? Speaking iniquity or wickedness, all ungodly speech, grumbling, gossip, slander, threatening, deceiving, doubt, and fear. All of that, get rid of that. So let me just summarize this. God says through Isaiah that true fasting, his chosen fast, is to treat each other in a godly way, without strife or criticism, accusation, or hurtful words or behavior, and to break the yoke of oppression, set free slaves, those oppressed, and to care for those in need, providing food, clothing, and shelter, especially your own family, all of this rather than pursuing your own desires. So do you get the picture here of, you know, the heart of God? It's not about you being without food. It's not about anything else. It's this is just so much is in his heart, treating everybody else well. So I want to just take a minute here and focus on God's instructions to break every yoke of oppression. Because sometimes people say, well, we don't worry about that. We don't have any slavery here in the U.S., right? Well, that commandment, that's a command of God, break every yoke of oppression. It applies to us on several levels, each of which we're called by God to pray for, work toward, speak out for, and take stand against. The first one is that whether you're aware of it or not, there are millions of people in actual slavery today. The people who study these days say that there are more slavery going on today than at any time in history. Amazing. In places like where the Islamic State had power, in Iran, in Sudan, in India, even though slavery is outlawed, there are millions of people who are actual under slavery. Second, there are billions, not just millions, but billions oppressed, heavy burdened, kept in wicked bondage by their government in our world today. Communist dictatorships in China, North Korea, Cuba, Venezuela, the people in those countries are oppressed. They are oppressed, and through war, like in the Ukraine and in many places in Africa where there have been wars, people are oppressed and heavily burdened. Other billions are oppressed by the lies of false religions. Hinduism, Islam, Christian cults, there are billions of people. Just in Hinduism, there are billions of people. So the fast and acceptable chosen by God includes praying and speaking and working toward bringing freedom to these people. And then the fourth level is that although slavery is illegal here in America today, and we live in a free country, people still oppress other people. Threats of violence, blackmail, removal of provision. This is the situation of many prostitutes, that they're under that kind of oppression. That's why they're out on the streets. Drug addicts, many people in dysfunctional families where there is abuse and oppression going on. So we need to pray and speak out and work toward bringing freedom in our homes, extended families, schools, and neighborhoods. And I'll say this, some of you hearing this message, you may be oppressed by someone, a spouse, a parent, an older sibling, a boss, a bully. God's word to you today is that his will is for you to be free. Free. 2 Corinthians Chapter 3 and verse 17 says, where the Spirit of Adonai, the Lord, is, there is freedom. So setting you free is what God calls his chosen fast. And we're going to be praying later to set you free. Now, here's another thing that might be happening. Some of you hearing this message today may be oppressing someone else. And you know what? When you are doing that, you're oppressed too. And you need to be set free and let that person free. So we're going to pray later for the convicting power of the Holy Spirit to be upon anyone hearing this who is holding someone else in bondage. God's command to you today is to loose those bonds. Now, I want to make sure to those who are under their parents' authority that this does not apply to parental authority over children. Children are to be under the authority of their parents or some older child, their older brother or sister. That is not oppression. So let's go back and look at Isaiah 58:6 once again. Is not this the fast I choose? To release the bonds of wickedness, to untie the cords of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to tear off every yoke. So there's an important understanding of the bonds of wickedness here. Many hearing this are themselves bound in bonds of wickedness and iniquity, heavily burdened and oppressed by Satan through deception. That's how he works. And an acceptable fast to God is to break those bonds. So we've talked about all of this in the whole world, but this is very personal, applied very personally. How do we break those bonds? Well, just by proclaiming it right now, by teaching and proclaiming God's truth that he wants freedom for you, and by praying for deliverance and removing of the power of the enemy over you. So later we're going to go pray and command those bonds to be broken, that yokes that have been placed on you by Satan. And we're going to be praying that during our three times of evening prayer so we can focus more on that. But there's another side to this word from the Lord, a deeper meaning to fasting that we're going to just end up here with. In Leviticus chapter 23, verse 27, it said, you are to afflict yourselves. So yourselves in Hebrew is the word nafshotekem. Nafshi is my soul. Nafshotekem is myself, my soul. So it could also be translated as you are to afflict your soul. Now, afflicting your soul means to deny your soul, humble your soul. And remember, or maybe you're hearing this for the first time, how the Bible describes human nature. God is a spirit, and you, all of you, are made in his image. So you are a spirit being. You are an immortal spirit being. Your spirit will never die. You live in a body, that's pretty clear, and you have a soul. Your mind, your emotions, your will, that's your soul. Your soul includes your reasoning ability, your giftings, your memories, your habits, your regrets, your fears, your doubts, any iniquity that you have like envy, bitterness, greed, or lust. Your soul in the New Covenant is often called your carnal nature or your old nature, your flesh. So to deny yourself or humble yourself or afflict your soul means to humble your soul by reducing the power or control that your soul has over you, the power that your carnal nature has over you, the power that your flesh has over your life. It means for the real you, the immortal spirit, to take control of your life, take control away from your soul, from your flesh. In Romans chapter 8, verse 14, Rabbi Shaul says this about this whole subject. All who are led by God's Spirit are God's sons. So your spirit connects with God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit. And when your spirit is in control, your spirit will be able to discern what God's Spirit is saying. When your soul is in control, then you're disconnected from God's Spirit. So you want to walk in the Spirit. That's what he's talking about here. All who are led by God's Spirit are God's sons. We call that walking in the Spirit. Being led by your spirit rather than your carnal nature or your soul. So the deeper meaning of a fast acceptable or chosen by the Lord is simply to walk in the Spirit, not in the flesh. Right? And we can do that every day. Every day we're supposed to walk in the Spirit and not the flesh. And what's the connection between humbling your soul and breaking the bondages that, see, when you're walking in the flesh, that's when you are in bondage to your flesh and to Satan, who can manipulate you through your flesh. So what's the connection between humbling your soul and breaking bondage? To be set free, you have to humble yourself in this way. You have to recognize and admit that you have areas of oppression in your life, or you can't get rid of them. Areas where Satan's deceptions have you in bondage. Areas in your life where you're not led by the Spirit, where you're led by your emotions, where you're led by your fears, where you're led by your reason, by habits, by bitterness, by lust, all of those things. If that's what your motivation is, that's what's driving you, those are areas of bondage. Those are areas of bondage. So how do you do this? Humble yourself by taking responsibility and saying, yeah, you know, I've lost my temper a few times in the last week. What's that? Is the temper part of your spirit or your soul? That's your soul. That's your old nature. Blowing up. Walking in fear. Is that your spirit or is that your soul? That's your soul in charge. Those are the times when you're not walking in the Spirit. So you have to be coming to the place of realizing that and humbling yourself and saying, yeah, I take responsibility for that. I gave into that. To that urge to blow up at somebody. I gave into that temptation to be depressed. I gave into that temptation to be greedy and to take something that was not mine. All of those things, you have to give into that. And here's how the enslavement comes. If you have habitually disobeyed God in some way and walked in that iniquity, Satan gains power over you to enslave you. So here's an example. If you regularly get drunk or take certain drugs, what happens to you? You get addicted, right? You become in bondage to it. It's just like that with all kinds of other forms of iniquity. If you use God's name in vain regularly, if you lie, if you lust, if you covet, if you hate, if you have bitterness, if you fall into fear, envy, jealousy, self-hatred, pride, rage, if you do that, Satan gains power over you. And pretty soon it becomes habitual to you. Just like if you take a drug, pretty soon it becomes habitual and you can't stop it. That's the power. When you're deceived by Satan into these attitudes, it gives him access to your life. And Satan will attempt to deceive you by speaking wickedness to you, tempting you. And sometimes people don't think of these like, oh, temptation is, you know, like a piece of cake. Or ice cream, that's a temptation, right? Or some sexual thing. But did you know that Satan tempts you to be depressed? Right? Satan tempts you to be bitter. Satan tempts you to be angry. They're not pleasant things, but they're temptations. And that's how Satan gets you to fall into these things. If you can't forgive, If you think about, oh, if only I had what he has, like envy. If you think, oh, if only I look like him or her, or I should be bitter about that. No one loves me. God doesn't love me. Oh, how about this one? I'd be better off dead. These are all temptations that people fall into. But when you do, that gives Satan power over you. He gains access to you through that. Another way he gains access is through your ancestry. And even that can be broken. So Yeshua, he came to bring us freedom from every form of bondage. And how? John chapter 8, verse 32, probably most of you know this. You can say it with me. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So simple. All you need to know is the truth, and you will be free. And what is the truth? This is the truth. Yeshua said, my word is truth. This is the truth. So it's in here. But for the truth to set you free, you need to do more than hear it once. Right? You need to receive it as important. You need to put your trust in it. You need to abide in it. It's what the Lord says. What does that mean? Abide in it. Here's my definition: is memorize it, meditate on it, obey on it, and obey it and act on it. That's what it means to abide in the truth, abide in His Word. His Word needs to renew your mind so you begin to think God's way. Your spirit begins to think God's way, not the way of this world. And when you put your trust in His Word as being the truth, Satan's bonds of wickedness can be broken off you, and that burden he puts on you will be lifted, and he no longer will have the right to oppress you, and every yoke he tries to put on you, you can hold it off and break it. So let's pray. So first of all, Lord, if anybody is holding someone else in bondage, I just pray your spirit would show them that. And we just repent and promise to set them free. We also repent of strife, quarreling, hurting others, accusation, judging, speaking evil. And we also repent of all the spirits that are keeping people from participating in this Esther fast, that are causing people to think, oh no, fasting's not for me. I'm not ready for that. I don't like that. We just break the power of every spirit, of every religious spirit that would say that that's just ritual. That's not really spiritual. We break the power of every spirit that would do that. So Father, we pray that you would help us keep your fast next week and every day, caring for others rather than pursuing our own desires and walking in the spirit, not in the flesh. We thank you for the promise of great rewards if we have an acceptable fast. And then, Lord, we pray for the freedom, for the millions of people in actual slavery today and the billions living under oppressive governments or religions. And we thank you, Lord. I'm so grateful that I was born into this free country. We are so thankful, Father, and we see our freedoms in danger. And so we pray, Father, that you would keep us free, that you would keep us a land of liberty, Father. And Lord, we pray once again for people of Ukraine. We pray you would set them free, protect them, and give them victory. We pray for the Russian people who are bound by deceptive propaganda to wake up and know the truth about what's happening. We pray for the power of Amalek over the Russian people and President Putin to be broken. We break that spirit of Amalek in the name of Yeshua. And Father, we put our trust in the truth of your words and the bondage-breaking power of your sacrifice and your name. And so we forgive anyone we are holding something against, and we ask that you would reveal to us any areas of bondage in our lives. Maybe we came in here or we started watching this thinking, I've got it all together, I'm just doing just fine. And Father, we just pray for your spirit somehow in our thoughts, in our dreams, in conversations, to reveal if there's bondage in our lives. We take responsibility for having allowed this bondage. We repent of all sin and iniquity that allowed Satan to bring us into these bondages. And I'm going to command bondages to several things to be broken, and you can just agree with me when you recognize that that might be a chain that's on you. And also, you can come to our prayer meetings for more prayer. So in the name of Yeshua, I command all the bondages that are spoken here, all these following, to be broken. Worry, anxiety, stress, we break the bondages. Fear, we break the bondage of fear. We break the bondage of unforgiveness, of resentment. In the name of Yeshua, we break any bondage that retaliation, hatred, violence. We break those bondages. We break that spirit that makes us unable to receive love or give love. We break it. We break a spirit of self-hatred's power over us, spirit of lust or spirit of addiction. We break any bondage to envy or jealousy, covetousness, and pride in the name of Yeshua. We break the bondage of rejection in our lives in the name of Yeshua. We are accepted We are accepted by the Lord. We break the bondage of low self-esteem in the name of Yeshua. And we recognize any shame or guilt or condemnation for the things we've repented of, and we repent of letting those things continue. We renounce shame and guilt and condemnation, and we've been forgiven. There is no more condemnation. And we command shame and guilt to leave and enable us, Lord, to stand against their return. And so, Father, as we go from here, as we go from here today, we just pray that we'd have a couple of days here until the prayer and fasting begins. But even in those days, Lord, we pray that your Spirit would be speaking to us, revealing areas of bondage, and that we would be able to deal with those things in the next 4 or 5 days as we approach Purim through this time of prayer. And we pray, Father, that these prayers that we are adding, there are millions of people praying the things that we have been praying against human trafficking and slavery, against the bondage of dictatorial governments. We believe, Father, that our prayers are being added. And I always think of the passage in the book of Revelation that says that there's a bowl in heaven, and the prayers of God's people are filling up that bowl. And when the bowl gets filled, it tips over and the prayers are answered. So, Lord, we pray that our prayers during this time of prayer and fasting would fill up the bowl, would fill up the bowl for Ukraine, for other places where there is bondage, and we would see people being set free. And also it would fill up the bowl in our own lives. And those prayers would be poured out, and we would see people even in the next week saying, I was set free. I was in bondage, and I'm free, free indeed. And we thank you today, Father, in Yeshua's name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670 or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service. Saturday morning, Complete Children's Program Interpretation for the Deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bengals and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick. You can also hear Bengals and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bengalsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Reg A. Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.